Welcome to my talk at SwissTax and Convents 2020. My name is Matthias Assenmacher from LMU Munich, and I'm going to talk about joint work with Christian Heumann, also from LMU Munich, on the comparability of pre-trained language models. So first of all, let me start with explaining the problem setting we are facing. Since at around 2018, transfer learning is nowadays used for solving most of the common NLP tasks. We have various benchmark data sets or data set collections around for evaluating these models. And we observe rapid improvements of state-of-the-art results on these benchmarks. A nice side effect of all these developments is that most of these pre-trained models are available open source, for example, via GitHub or the Transformers package. And despite all these developments are pretty nice, we think that there are some points that aren't taken into account. Because all these models, of course, differ in the architecture and their pre-training objective. That's what makes them different. But besides this, they also differ in the number of parameters, meaning the model size. They differ concerning the pre-training resources utilized for pre-training these models and the open source availability of these resources. And they differ concerning the compute that is utilized for pre-training these models. So what we claim is that it is maybe not that straightforward to distinguish where these improvements of the state-of-the-art results originate from. What research goals did we wanted to reach with our work? We wanted to provide an overview on the differences in resource demand of these recent state-of-the-art models. We wanted to clarify where the architectural differences are. We wanted to gain some kind of intuition for the different impacts of these aforementioned differences on the model performance. And in the end, we want to propose some tentative ideas and starting points for better reporting standards in order to make models more comparable and in order to foster reproducible research. Let me give you an overview over the models we evaluated. Starting with the two models, ULMFIT and ELMO, we are looking at LSTM-based models, making use of the standard language modeling objective, one of them unidirectional, one of them in a bidirectional way. All the other models we were evaluating are transformer-based. Starting with the two GPT architectures, which are both unidirectional transformer models, making also use of the standard language modeling objective. And they are thus somewhat related to these LSTM-based models. Kind of a revolution started with the introduction of BERT, which was the first model in October 2018, to simultaneously using a transformer model and being able to do bidirectionally contextual modeling. They did this by introducing the masked language modeling objective. And the three models at the bottom of this table are some alternatives and improvements over BERT. Roberta and Albert are BERT-based models, which did some improvements. And XLNet is an autoregressive transformer model, which achieves bidirectionality by doing permutation language modeling. In this table, we wanted to give an overview on the different pre-training resources, meaning the corpora used for pre-training these models, their size and their accessibility. First of all, what we can see is that there are corpora of different quality. For example, if we compare the English Wikipedia corpus to the Common Crawl corpus, we can say that the Wikipedia corpus is of higher quality than the Common Crawl corpus, which is based on just a web crawl of the whole internet. We can see in the second column that there are large differences between the size of these corpora. And we can see that some of these are normally fully available, some of them have to be paid for, and some of the corpora aren't even available at all. Other main takeaway from this table is that we can see that most of the models are making use of the English Wikipedia corpus and the books corpus. All of the other corpora are mainly used by one or two models in conjunction with these or one of these two corpora. So we can state that there is a difference between the models concerning the size and the quality of the pre-training corpora used. Concerning the resource usage, we can also see some differences. In this table, we show in the first column the computational resources used for pre-training, and in the second column, we display the training time. We use these two information points for calculating some point of some standardized measure, PFS days here. We took this measure from a blog post from the OpenAI guys, and it is thought of a standardized measure to make the amount of compute used for pre-training comparable across models. In the last two columns, we show the number of parameters, meaning the model size, and we also show the lexical resources, meaning the size of the pre-training corpora in gigabyte. When we have a look at this PFS days column, we see that there are some partially large differences between the amount of compute utilized for pre-training. We can also see, when having a look at these NAs appearing in this table, that not all of these models are making statements about which computational resources they use, for how long, and thus we are not able to compute the PFS days measure for all of the models. For Roberta, we included two models in this table, since the authors reported the computational resources used and the training time for some smaller Roberta model, which uses the same computational the same lexical resources for pre-training as BERT does. For this model, we were able to compute the PFS days measure. For the normal Roberta model in the line above, the authors didn't specify the exact training time, so we weren't able to compute the PFS days. This is mainly the result of our paper, a large comparison of the model performances of the different models on some of the most commonly used benchmarks. Let me quickly guide you through this table. What can we see here? In the columns, we see the different benchmarks or benchmark collections, namely the GLUE benchmark, the Stanford question answering data set, and the RACE dataset, which is a reading comprehension task. For GLUE, we report the leaderboard scores of the different models and the development set scores, excluding WNLI here. For SQUAD, we report the development set scores for two different versions, for the 1.1 version and for the 2.0 version. 2.0 version includes also non-answerable questions. And for the RACE benchmark, we report the test set results. We again include the number of parameters and the lexical resources used in this table, but contrary to before, we include them as factors. We have one reference model. In most of the cases, it is BERT-based. And we report the number of parameters and the amount of lexical resources used for pre-training as factors compared to this reference model. So what is the first impression we get from this table? We can see that a lot of cells aren't even filled. So that means that not all of the models are evaluated on all of the benchmarks. So it seems to be dependent on the author which benchmark data set he or she or them use. When we start comparing the models, for example, we can compare BERT Base to the GPT model. It might seem obvious that BERT Base is superior to the GPT model because it has a better architecture and a better pre-training objective. Since we compare two transformer-based models of approximately the same size, what often isn't taken into account that BERT has access to at least double of the pre-training resources compared to GPT-2. So this might also be a source for the better performance of BERT. If we compare the different models on the Glue leaderboard scores, we can see here that these three models, namely XLNet, Roberta, and Albert, are reporting the performance values for ensemble models. And for these ensemble models, they seem to be highly superior to the BERT-based models, since they are beating even the BERT large model by about 8 or even 9 percentage points. This is why we also report the development set scores, where we have access to the scores of single XLNet, Roberta, and Albert models. And if we have a look at the second column here, we can see that the advantage that XLNet, Roberta, and Albert seem to have over BERT large is cut approximately by half if we compare single models instead of ensemble models here. Some other interesting points is that if we have a look at the performance on squat for BERT large and XLNet large, which were trained on approximately the same pre-training resources, and despite BERT large is about 3 times of the size of XLNet base, the comparison gets somewhat fairer. And we can see that the performance of this small XLNet model is about comparable to BERT large. Also, if we have a look at the performance of XLNet base compared to the performance of BERT base on the RAISE test set, we can see that these two models aren't that dissimilar concerning their performance. For ULMFIT, we couldn't get the scores on these aforementioned benchmark datasets since ULMFIT wasn't evaluated on these benchmarks, but we could obtain performance values of BERT large and XLNet large on the data sets ULMFIT was evaluated on. What we can see here is that these two models are much larger and use much larger pre-training resources, but only yield small improvements over the performance of ULMFIT. This might be because these data sets are conceptually rather simple compared to the others, and that ULMFIT already achieves very high performance values. So the improvements provided by BERT and XLNet aren't that large anymore. So let me quickly summarize the main takeaways we can take from the tables before. The size and the quality of the pre-training resources does seem to have an impact on the model performance. If we compare single models to ensemble models, this might be misleading, since the ensemble models have an unfair advantage through the ensembling approach. The amount of compute that is spent for pre-training is not always reported, or is reported in different degrees of detail. And it is almost never reported in relation to benchmark performance. Overall, we can see that the reporting standards are some kind of a patchwork carpet, since it is highly dependent on the author what benchmark scores they report. And we see that there are few external universal standards. Most of the authors at the moment state that their model architecture A is superior to some model architecture B on performing task X. We would propose that it might be better to coin these statements in another way and to say that the model architecture A is superior to model architecture B on performing task X when being pre-trained on a small or respectively large corpus of low or high quality data from domain Y. So the main question is, why don't we have benchmark corpora for pre-training? As already mentioned before, there are large differences when it comes to the description of computational resources used for pre-training. Some don't provide any information at all, and while some others provide partial information, maybe also only on the hardware or on the hardware and training time. Only in one case, we could observe that the authors went the extra step and calculated some standardized measure. So why don't we have universal or unified reporting standards here? And as a last tentative proposal, we observe that at the moment, every author reports the performance of one best performing potentially or also model ensemble on some benchmark. And we propose some more differentiated considerations. One should take into consideration the interference between influences of different sources, meaning pre-training resources, computational resources. One should consider low, medium, and high resource settings for these different sources. And one should also report or letting interact the different model sizes and training times and evaluate then on the benchmarks. So the question is, why don't we have complete benchmark pipelines with a fixed amount of compute and pre-training resources for evaluating our models? So far, thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to discussing your questions.